enjoy what God has done for you through his son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Tell you what, I'm going to try and weave together black bears, bicycle seats, bulging eyeballs, and announcements into what it all makes sense. So give me some grace here. All right, amen. Amen. This is the fourth week of August, and I've been thinking about this past week as transitions. What are transitions? I think we gave our kids a three-week countdown till school begins. One of my children enrolled for college and is paying for books. You can look outside and deny the fact that those leaves are changing from green to yellow, and they are littering the ground, and you have to blow the leaves up before you cut the grass. Yes, so we're transitioning spiritually, physically, all kinds of things. So good morning, Hope in Christ Church, and those about you out there in live stream land, welcome. And I hope you enjoyed being with us this morning, or whatever time you choose to watch this. I see lots of faces out there, and you're welcome. I'll try and do some housekeeping here. We here at Hope in Christ Church, if you're visiting with us today, would like to reach out and get to know you. There's a connect card out back. Take and fill that out. Someone, if you're new here, will reach out to you and get you a welcome packet if they haven't done so already. But we want to just let you know that we care about you. We want to know more about you. Let's see, a prayer connect card. If you would like to have prayers for yourself, just discreet, there on the back stand back there, you can put it in the offering box. We're going to be having some baptisms coming up pretty soon. That is exciting. To be determined. Last week we had a new members class, and that was great to sit down with some folks who wanted to learn more about Hope in Christ Church and what we're about. We talked about spiritual growth and serving. Okay, I'll be touching that point in a bit. So let me get to the announcements. So August 30th, we're going to have our own Ariana. She is our missionary. Her and Chris Neuswanger will be here with CWAM. It's an update. And we're going to be taking a love offering. So this is the love offering box. I'll put this in the back on your way out. We're doing this for a couple weeks. A love offering for Chris and Ariana. So you can make checks payable to Chris and Ariana Neuswanger. Okay. And after that, after our church service, we're going to have an ice cream social in a fellowship outside after the service. September 12th. At 9:30 a.m., the Common Threads Outreach is going to take place, so please reach out to Katie here today or at the church office. And we're going to have our semi-annual meeting and picnic Saturday, September 12th, and that time will be determined. Operation Christmas Child is taking place and ramping up and going great places, and thank you for your generous donations. So please see Paula. Or the display in the foyer out back, or contact the church office for any questions. And we are continuing our undercover pantry. And the coolers are going to be out between 8 a.m. and noon, Monday through Thursday. So what do black bears, bicycle seats, have to do in common, bulging eyes? Well, I'll try and weave that together for you. And transitions. I hit 2020 with the endeavor to get my body, like the Apostle Paul said, whipped back into submission. And then COVID hit, and I hurt my leg running, so I couldn't do anything for like 3 months. And I got my bike fixed just recently, so I could take my favorite 8-year-old daughter out on activities. So we've been doing that. So last Saturday, we went out for a bike ride, and as soon as you get out my driveway is a hill. So when I run, I take my car and I drive up the hill. So I can't do that. I can't do that with my bike. So I got to pedal up the hill. So as I get out, pedal up the hill, my body goes into convulsions and say, "What are you doing? Get off the bike, either walk or go back home, because this is not right." So my eyes are bulging and my heart rate is increasing and saying, "This is so wrong." Okay. So I'm trying to get my heart right physically. Okay. So I don't stop. I've never stopped when I was a kid as to up the hill, to always pedal up the hill, don't stop. Because once you stop, it's easy to quit the next time, okay? It's always easy for me to quit, so I'm trying to press my 8-year-old daughter to not to quit, because it's easier to quit the next time. So I make it up the hill. I didn't die. I wanted to die. made it through. So we went again on Sunday, and that bulging eyes didn't bulge quite so much. My heart didn't want to bust out my chest so much. And I did it again on Tuesday. You know what happened on Tuesday? I didn't want to die. My eyes didn't bulge so much, and I felt better, and I didn't quit. Okay, so there's the getting my heart right physically, trying to beat my body into submission, like the Apostle Paul said we should be doing. I should care for that. Spiritually getting my heart right. Spiritually getting my heart right. We've been talking about some practical things. James is a great, great book I happen to appreciate. Thank Steve for choosing this book to teach us some good practical things about spiritual growth and application in your life. So getting your heart right. But before I get there, you have to be prepared for stuff that you're going to encounter. If you don't have a plan, you're not going to be prepared. So bicycle seats. Now, I don't understand this. We can send men to the moon, rocket ships to Mars. We can fast track vaccines for COVID, but we haven't spent much time on the bicycle seat. I don't understand that, right? It doesn't cover very much surface area. Get what I mean? Okay. So either I can borrow a saddle from Mike, or a tractor seat. Okay. They should spend some time on that. Yesterday we went for a bike ride on the Northern Rail Trail, and I wasn't prepared. I wasn't prepared to see bear. Okay. I saw a cubby bear and a mama bear. Okay. And when I finally realized what it was, I could see the black and the brown. It stood up. I'm like, those aren't people. Those are bear. And I thought, where is Annalie? She's way back there. I'm like, hey, come see this. Come see the bear. Well, I'm looking at the bear. Look at me. And I'm looking at Annalie. Get up here so you can see the bear. But then they started running in parallel with us. And I thought, should I pedal faster than Annalie? Or keep up with her to push her? Don't stop. So, man, what a blessing to see black bear. I wasn't prepared to see black bear yesterday. Okay. So spiritually, what's that look like? Are you prepared for the battles or the unknowns in your life that you're not ready for? Spiritual growth. I had two opportunities this past week to give into my flesh. But what I did instead was to continue reading the Word of God. And in doing so, that spirit, that fleshly desire to give in to that sin, that dissipated. And I had victory. I didn't stop. Because if I had stopped, you know what would have happened? It'd be easier for me the next time to quit and to give in. So the end of Todd and beginning of Jesus Christ, amen. So what we're trying to do here at Hope in Christ Church is to grow spiritually. In our new members class, we talked about that. There is a spiritual growth. I told you last week that I gave my life to Christ in 1982. Then a recommitment back in 1996. But my life has changed since then. If I was a spiritual infant and still, if I didn't know where the book of Matthew was or Revelation or Genesis, that's a problem. So we would endeavor here to have spiritual growth. And in doing that, also serving the church. So there's lots of opportunity here to do that. Tuesday night at 6:30, there's an opportunity for Revelation Bible studies. There's small groups. There's the, our common threads to connect. So we here want to do that, but it was really good to talk about those nitty-gritty everyday things in our new members class. So there's lots to do here at Hope in Christ. If you're looking for a place to serve or for a church home, you're welcome here. We want you where God wants you. So I'll say that. So transitions, it's time to reflect upon what God has been doing in this past week in your life, the challenges. I praise God that he doesn't give me all the bad things all at once. Amen. I can deal with one thing at a time, and praise God for that. There, we sat outside Friday night, and we could see the meteor showers, just praising God for his creation. And transitions. Summer is getting over into fall time. So I'm going to invite you to bow your heads to me, please, as I pray. So Heavenly Father, I do thank you for this day that you've planned for us to come in obedience, to set our lives aside for a time, and to ascribe to you glory and honor, worth, to lower ourselves and raise you up, to to recognize who you are and your awesomeness and your power, your incredible patience, your mercy and your love. You're awesome and you're powerful. And you love me and you love us. So Lord, I pray that you'd help us this morning through your Holy Spirit, ascribe glory and honor unto you. And I thank you, Lord, for who you are and what you're going to do and what you're doing in our lives. Thank you. May you be honored. And in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Let's worship God.
Will you stand as we continue? Psalm 31 says, "For you are my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, you lead me and guide me. You take me out of the net they have hidden for me. For you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, my faithful God.
Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness."
Thank you.
And may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He surely will do it. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, Hope in Christ Church.
Good morning.
This is the time we're going to release the kids and the teachers for Kids Church. Last week we had Kid Church, just no S, but we did have one, and we have, as Pastor Steve said, a soft rollout for the next few weeks. We see some kids with an S leaving now along with the teachers, so praise God as he moves us along one step at a time. This is the time we also normally take our offering, and as we're still not passing the plate, we encourage you on your way out, both in the back of the church, the little wooden house-like building, and on the side over here by the side door is the wooden box. You can place your tithes and offerings in those if you are so inclined. And we also want to, again, thank you for your faithfulness. Through this time, your faithfulness to support the ministries here at the church have been strong and solid, and we really appreciate that. But what's better than that is that God really desires to bless us through our giving, not just our finances, but our time and the gifts that he has given to us for the purpose of really promoting the ministries here. He doesn't need our money. You hear us say that all the time. What he wants is our hearts. And so we really appreciate you continuing your support and staying solid. And we know that as such, God promises blessings. And so you no doubt are experiencing those blessings as you give of your time, talents, and finances, and you can expect to continue. So now is our time to share praise and prayer requests from the body. Those of you at home, as we've said, we have a listing each week with our prayer request and some praises on it. If you would like to receive that via email, you can request that on our website. And we'll be happy to email you that every week so that you can pray along with us at home. And you can be reminded of what these requests are throughout the week. Todd mentioned that we had a new members class last week, and we spoke about commitment and the covenant and God's gifting. It was a real blessing for me. There were seven people there, and attending a new members class here at Hope in Christ does not commit you to becoming a member. What it does do is it provides you an opportunity to learn what we are about, our purpose, what we believe, what we expect of you as a member, and then it's between you and the Lord whether you want to proceed. So one of the prayer requests this morning that we have is that the Lord would reveal to those who are in the members class whether he would have them to become members. We talk about the process of what we call membering, which is becoming a member here at Hope in Christ, because of our bylaws, allows you to vote on different things that we have throughout the year and on the leadership positions and all. But it also provides you opportunities to be in leadership and to participate within many ministries in the church. So we want you here if God wants you here. And if God is leading you somewhere else, or not to member at this time, that's what we desire. We just really want his purpose for you and for us. So with that being said, who else has something they would like to share that's a praise this morning before we talk about our prayer request? We know that God is moving, so let's hear from someone. Pastor Steve.
The statistics that we get on the pandemic seem to be really an answer to our prayers right now in New Hampshire.
Steve says that
what did we expect to happen?
That's right. That the statistics before the pandemic are in New Hampshire here are getting much better, and the number is much smaller in answer to prayer. And so that is certainly a praise. Anyone else? Alice. Very good. So Alice said that she has an appointment with the orthopedist to look at her knees. We want to keep that in prayer. Alice needs those knees not only to walk, but we need our knees also to support us when we come down before the Lord and we're on those knees, which sometimes is not often enough, is it? But praise God. I look out and I see a number of young adults here with us this morning, and that's just nice to see. And we want to really, as a church, be committed to be praying for our young adults, that God will give them direction in what he has. He already knows the plans that he has for you, but sometimes it's hard for us to discern. And so we want to be praying for each one of you, that God will guide you and show you the footsteps to take one at a time in your life. It's an exciting time to have your whole life in front of you. And sometimes you know where you want to go and sometimes you don't, but God knows your path. He's already planned. And so we're glad to see you all here. How about prayer requests? Does anyone have a particular prayer request they would like to bring before us this morning?
I wanted to go back real quick to the praise.
Okay, Katie. That's great to just be able to praise God for Kate's two young children, to see the young adults that are here in their midst. And it's a good thing, and they will model after you. Just as hopefully you will model after us old timers that are here. And it's I used to hear this all the time when I was young from the old guys, that boy, life is so quick, and it's before you know it, you're looking back, and now I am one, and it is true. Life goes by very, very quickly. So it is good to see you here. So we have some prayer requests here on our list. First we have Kevin and Katie, and we would like to remember Kevin's mom who needs healing and peace. And I believe she's in Boston in the hospital. So we want to remember her. And also Katie as well, who needs prayer for some healing and for some peace as well. Mark Cronus is on the road in Chicago, and he has a big job that he is doing there. And it's a difficult job, and it's compounded by the COVID issue. So we want to keep him in our prayers for safety while he's there, and that he can get his work done. We've talked about Alice. We know that that Bonnie went home to be with the Lord recently. We know we need to still continue to keep her loved ones and friends in prayer. And we also know that Al Glidden went home to be with the Lord this week. Al and Diane attended here for many years, and Al has been sick for quite a long time. So these are always difficult things when someone we know and love is gone, but it's also a time for rejoicing to know that they will be with our Lord for eternity, and we will see them again. We want to continue to pray for Donna's brain aneurysm and for Kaylee's friend who's been diagnosed with lung cancer. Also on the list is we have a church that we've been praying for that will change from time to time. Pembroke Congregational Church is the one that's on the list right now. Why do we do this? It's because we are all part of the great body of Christ, each individual church. And just as within this body we have many different functions and gifts, God does that with each church also in the overall body, in the universal body. And so we want to pray for one another. And so we ask you to continue to pray for Pembroke Congregational Church this week. Our ministries here at Hope in Christ, we ask for prayer for TLC. We're struggling with how we can structure things so that TLC can meet effectively and efficiently in the midst of the COVID issue. Also, as we roll out our kids' church program, the same thing, that we have to structure it in such a way that we feel is how God would have us do that. It's very difficult because we don't have any scripture to go to that says this is what you do when you have a pandemic. And so we all have our thoughts and our ideas. So we need God's wisdom, how we can bring Awana back to beginning in the church and pick up where we've been. Ministries to reach people. We need your prayer. Our online visitors, it's amazing to us how God uses the online part of our service since we were forced to do that with COVID, and how it is reaching people. We are hearing from people online. We see that we have many, many people that are watching on a weekly basis. And so we want to be praying for those people. First, that if they don't know the Lord Jesus, that they would open their hearts and not be afraid to just crack that door open to the one true God. He will answer. And if they do know the Lord, that they have and they have requests or needs, that we are holding them up as well. Even though we don't know the specifics, God knows those. We pray for our law enforcement and all the issues that are going on in our country. Hold these men and women up. They are serving us and putting their lives on the line. And we pray that God would strengthen us as a country. And finally, the ministries here at Hope in Christ. We mentioned the children's ministries, but we need God's wisdom, as always, to know where to put our resources and what he would have us to do as a church. We have specific needs in the community here, and we want to be used effectively by him. We want to reach the lost, and we want to minister to those that are in need. So we want to continue to be praying. So now, if you would join with me this morning, I am always reminded that God says to come boldly before the throne of grace. Do we know what that really means, that we can come with boldness but with humility before the throne of grace, the grace that God gives to us, that gives us eternal life, and that allows us to come as imperfect people who sin and who are selfish and carry much baggage, but God still encourages us to come before him and share our needs, that he will hear and listen. So, Father, you have heard us. First of all, thank you for the blessings that you are giving to us. Thank you for sustaining our local church in the midst of the last number of months, Lord, and in fact, even growing it. Thank you for providing for us financially. Lord, thank you for providing workers to work in the ministries. Thank you for providing people, Lord, to step in and figure out how we can go online, how we can make that work, Lord, and to have the talents to be able to do that. Father, we thank you for the people who are online that are able to either not be here yet, who will be here, or who will never be here, Lord, because they're not in our local community but are hearing your word. We praise you that your Holy Spirit is working in everyone, Lord, that your word does never fail and will never be void. It will always be truth. Father, we pray for the loved ones and the family of those who have passed on to be with you recently, Lord. We thank you that we can celebrate and we can know deep within that even though we miss them and we mourn their death, that it's really not death. It's only death to us while we are here, but it's the beginning of eternal life with you, and we thank you. Lord, we thank you for our young people that are here with us this morning and may be listening and are a part of our body. Many of them have grown up in this body, Lord, and some have not. We ask, Lord, that you would make your way clear to them, that you would grow their faith, Lord, and that they would learn to trust you as you do, and to be willing to take the one step at a time that you show them to take, Lord, and to not be afraid to trust you, to listen to your voice, Father, and to be obedient. And we pray that, Father, for each one here in our church, not just the young people, but that we would be sensitive to your leading. We pray, Father, all the time that you would guide us and lead us. But we pray, Father, that we will take the time to be quiet before you and to listen for your voice and to hear that voice within, and that we will be obedient and submissive to you, Lord, and we will put ourselves aside. Lord, we pray for the children's ministries and the outreach within this body, Lord, that you will give us wisdom and gentleness and love one for another, Lord, that you will help us to be able to put together plans and programs that work, that are effective and sensitive, Lord, and it's such a balance, and we need your guidance. Father, we pray for our country that's in turmoil in many ways. We pray, Father, that you would select leaders from the president on down, Lord, to our local communities, that you would select leaders who might seek you and seek your face and not be afraid, Lord, to lead in accordance with your word and with your leading, and to put personal agendas aside, Lord. We pray for healing for our police and fire and other first responders. We pray, Lord, that our country would not be afraid of authority, and that authority would be used with humility, Father, and with tempering with your word and your teachings, and that we can come back together, Father, as a country. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. The things that we haven't mentioned this morning, Lord, the needs, we hold them before you as well. You know what's in our hearts. You know what's in our needs here in this body. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to serve. We thank you for bringing workers into our body, as your word says, Lord. We thank you for our pastor and his wife, and we thank you, Father, for the teaching that you will be bringing us here this morning through him. We pray, Father, for encouragement for our pastor and for the leaders, all the leaders in the ministry and the workers in the ministry, Father, and for blessings as they give of their time, Father, for you, in Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thank you, Paul and Todd, for your take on what we're doing here today. What a great encouragement to look out and see so many faces here. Every week we fill up a little more and more, and that's very encouraging. That transitions, you know, like Todd was talking about. We are again back into the book of James, chapter 2, verse 20. I'm going to take it up to about verse 26. And if you have your Bibles and your insert and your pen, we can get going with that. If you want to get this stuff ahead of time, you can call the office, or you could actually type right into the Facebook that you're watching us on now with your email address, and we can get that to you ahead of time. And the prayer list that Paul was just going through, along with the sermon outline and all the stuff that's going on in our church here, will be emailed to you at some point during the week, usually Thursday or so. So today James is going to be continuing to explain to us about the results of our faith. How our faith is seen when we have true life-saving, life-changing, real active faith in our life. Faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. What is that going to look like? Last week, he contrasted what he called dead faith with live faith. And this week, he's going to continue on with a couple of twists. We're going to look at it just a little bit different this week. He explains this week that true faith brings justification. And it's not a topic that we've explored here over the last couple of years. So first, I want to illuminate that all for you with an illustration. I'm going to do the best I can with justification, okay? picture a guy saving up for a great vacation, okay? He wants to tour the countryside in a luxury car and see the country firsthand. So he saves up all his money, he comes up with a budget, he buys a Rolls Royce. That's how you do it, buy a Rolls Royce. He sets off on his vacation. He gets out in the middle of, say, Decatur, Illinois, because that's on my mind today. And he's driving along and the motor shuts off and the Rolls coast to a stop and it won't budge. Stuck on the side of the road with a Rolls that won't roll. So he picks up his cell phone. He starts to think, what do I do? So he calls Rolls-Royce, West Sussex, England. Hello, Rolls-Royce. Yep, Rolls-Royce here. My car just shut off. I'm in the middle of nowhere out in Illinois. What do I do? The Rolls-Royce guy says, don't you move a muscle. You wait right there. It's okay. A few minutes later, a taxi cab pulls up. Takes him, takes all of his luggage, brings him to a luxury hotel. So you wait right here. Somebody will be in touch. A few days later, there's a knock on the door. A gentleman stood there with his car keys and says, your car is ready. Well, he's excited. He can go on with his trip, but before he could get any other further explanation, the guy disappeared down the hallway. So he went on with his trip. He started thinking about, wow, that was incredible service. They sent somebody all the way from England to fix my car. How am I going to pay for this? I'll never be able to pay for what they did. I put some guy on a plane, sent him all the way over here to Illinois and fix my car. So he was bothered him the whole time. He got home. He called Rolls-Royce and he said, how am I going to pay for what you guys did for me? They said, well, I'm sorry, sir, but there's no record here in our files of anything that ever went wrong with your Rolls-Royce. The record we have here of your Rolls-Royce is that it has and always will be in perfect working order. And this is really an illustration of justification. Best I could do. Sorry. And that's what James is really going to be talking about here today. To be justified by God is for God to have no record of you being anything but perfect. Because the perfection of Christ has been applied to your life. That's what they call imputed to you. Okay, it's been laid over your life. So, just so we get up to speed, I want to start from scratch and work up to justification. All people have a sinful nature that controls their thoughts and their actions and separates them from God. You don't have to work at that. Okay, we do fine with that all by ourselves. But God is perfect in every way, and he can't be in a close relationship with a sinful creature. That's bad news for all people. But the good news is that he loves us so much, he's made a way for all people to come to him and to be loved and cared for eternally, joined to him. Right? As a child of God, he sent his son to live with us, still fully God, but fully human as well. And he lived here with us and he never sinned. He lived that perfect life that we could not. And then he willingly laid down his life on the cross and accepted the punishment for our sins, made the payment for our sins, so that we could accept his record of perfection. And God is a perfectly good God. He's a perfectly just God. Okay, he has to judge and punish sin, or else he wouldn't be perfectly just. He doesn't have an option. He can't look the other way and still be perfectly just. So when a person comes humbly before God and admits their sin, admits that they're unable to live according to his word on their own, they repent, okay? They turn away from their sinful lives, and they believe in the perfect life of Christ and its substitutionary work to accept the penalty of our sins. Then we can be justified. We can be seen as having no record of sin in the eyes of God. And we're justified in his eyes, seen as perfectly good, perfectly righteous by the work of Christ. And then we enter a time of new life filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's what we saw last week in our sermon, what that looks like to other people in our lives. Right? The saving faith of the gospel is evident by the fruit in our life. That's what we looked at last week. And that fruit was all in relation to the people, you know, our relationships with the people around us. Right? Our faith wasn't just words and thoughts. It was action. Right? And it caused us to have compassion, to understand the needs of other people, and to work on them. And also made us repentant and teachable. Okay, this week, the playing field has changed. Right? Again, we're looking at the products of our faith, but this week, James is explaining how the products of our faith will be seen from God's perspective. From God's perspective, a person with real, living faith is a person that's been justified. And I've given you a basic definition there on your outline of justification. Justification is an instantaneous legal act of God in which he declares that our sins are forgiven. Christ's perfect life is imputed to us, right? Given to us, so that's all he sees. And we're seen as righteous in his sight. And it's important for us to understand that our faith doesn't justify us, right? Our faith makes it possible for God to justify us. So just a little detail there that you need to understand. And just like last week, we went back to Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 for insight on what leads up to the justification. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your doing. It's the gift of God, not a result of works, so no one can boast. So just like the repair records of our friend's Rolls Royce, our brokenness isn't seen. We're perfect in his eyes. When we have the real saving faith, right? We're justified by God because of his grace and mercy and care. And this justification is going to have some real products in our life as seen by God. And this is really our big idea, our main theological principle for this entire sermon. The one thing that I hope that you'll bring home from this message is that the saving faith of the gospel produces a justified life that's available to all Christians. So I talked about justification, what justification is. So we got that. What's a justified life? Well, since I made that up, I'm going to have to be the one that explains it to you. It's knowing that you're justified and living as a person freed from sin, freed from its penalty. Right? Justification is a thing that all Christians experience. A justified life is something that all Christians can learn to live as we grow in faith. It's taking full advantage of our justification. Right? So with that, let's take a look at our scripture. James 2:20. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see, that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. And he was called personally. I know other people have the views on this. Personally. I really think it's a benefit to all Christians to read scripture through a book and not to jump around so much. Because you build up this context, and like these sermons, they build up a momentum, and you go from verse to verse to verse to verse. So just something I wanted to get out of the way before we got going here. If we go back a little bit last week, because I really want to be clear how this works, the relationship between faith and works. Last week, James was talking about two types of faith, right? Real, alive faith that unites us with God by belief in the gospel of Jesus Christ that must lead to action, right? That's where we were last week. This is the faith that God sees and declares us justified. And then he also talked about dead, useless faith. Right? It was just words. It was just thoughts. It doesn't present any evidence in people's lives. No justification available from God if a person only has dead faith. So, why do you think James uses the term dead faith instead of just saying, like Paul always says? I mean, why does James use the term dead faith when Paul would use the term no faith? Right? I mean, that's a legitimate question. You know, you never really see Paul talking about these different types of faith. You got faith or you don't. Well, remember who James is writing to, right? He's writing to converted Jews. Right? And this is an early book. We talked about that last week. Right? If the scholars are correct in piecing this all together, everybody that's under 15 years old were the only ones that would have been born into a Christian household. Everybody over 15 years old, because that's how far this book is removed from the death of Christ, everybody over 15 years old would have been born in the Jewish faith. And that's who he's writing to. And to a Jewish person, faith was a part of life. If you're Jewish, you had faith. At least you claimed you had faith. It was cultural, traditional. It was an ethnic characteristic of all Jews. They all claimed to have faith in God. That's what made a Jew a Jew. Right? So all Jews would have claimed to have faith. That's why James is calling no faith dead and useless, instead of just saying, like Paul would have, you don't have any. That's kind of what brings us into James and the part of James where people have problems with James. That's why. It's because the audience that he is talking to. So James is going to illustrate the products of a Christian's faith in the gospel as they relate to God. And again, because of the Jewish heritage, he's going to anchor these points in two heroes of the Old Testament, Abraham and Rahab. Two very different people, right? But both showed God their true faith by their actions. Okay, actions that were only possible because of their faith. The good works that accompanied their faith. Right? The same type of works that will be produced in our lives as well because of our faith. And James is going to outline three of these things for us today. Okay, and the first one is, a Christian's faith produces obedience to God. Right, to make this point, James goes to the number one draft pick of God, right? Abraham. And if you're going to be arguing about how to hit a baseball, right? I mean, you would go to, Babe Ruth did it that way, Ted Williams did it that way, and that's what James is going to here. He's going to the best example, the number one guy. So who's Abraham and why is he a great example of this justified life that I'm talking about here? Well, God called Abraham from his homeland, tells him to go out into a land that I'll show you. He didn't say, you know, go to Pembroke, right? He said, go, I'll show you. And he also makes him three promises. A promise of land of his own, the promise to be made into a great nation, and the promise of continued blessings. Right? And Abraham obeyed because he believed. Genesis, we're going to go back to Genesis a few different times to show how this works. Genesis 12:4, Abraham went as the Lord had told him. Much later in his life, God commanded Abraham, take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah, and sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on the mountain I will show you. This was an astounding command because Isaac was the son of promise. Right? He was his only son. He was the basis for how God's promise that from Abraham's own body would come a nation. right? And in chapter 21 of Genesis, that this promise would be fulfilled through Isaac. So what's up with that direction from God? Right? So Abraham's in a tough spot. I mean, he's thinking to himself, all right, God called me to be the father of a nation dedicated to him and his purposes. Got it. God told me that this nation and these people would be my descendants and they would be through Isaac. And then God says to go sacrifice Isaac. I know there was no Sesame Street back then, but one of these things is not like the other, right? That's what I was thinking of. What do you do when God does things to make you go, huh? Or is that just me that happens to? What do you do when God tells you to do something that makes no sense? And you think you got it figured out in your head and you explain it to somebody and they look at you like, you know that look your dog gives you? You know, like that? Or that's just my dog, I don't know. Or maybe I'm the only one that talks to my dog and expects him to. Never mind. All right. Abraham trusted and obeyed out of faith. Your faith will lead you to obedience. Right? If you follow your faith, if you act according to your beliefs like Abraham did, you'll see what develops out of your faith and obedience, just like Abraham did. And we'll move on a little bit through Genesis. Early the next morning, Abraham got up, he loaded his donkey and headed out with his son with the wood for a burnt offering. And up the way, up the mountain, to the place of sacrifice, Isaac said, Dad, where's the sacrifice? And Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And he did. Abraham moved to obey and sacrifice Isaac, and God provided a substitute, a ram caught in a thicket to take Isaac's place. Almost like God wanted all people for all time to understand that when they submit to God, act in obedience through faith, he will provide a substitute for their spiritual death. Bigger things flow out of our obedience than we can even, most of the time, even dream of. The reason that James can say Abraham was justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar was because these works weren't alone. They were accompanied by and made possible by living faith, right? And verse 22 explains it. His faith was active along with his works. And the faith was completed by his works. That's the faith and works of a justified life that God wants to see in us. A life of obedience because of our faith. I mean, what would you do? Like, every day, right, your husband or wife told you that they loved you. Love you, honey. Yeah, love you too. But never showed it. Never did anything about it. What if your boss is forever telling you how indispensable you are? But he's always looking over your shoulder and checking up on you. Right? Those things sound ridiculous, right? They sound like they don't fit together, but they're no more ridiculous as saying you're a Christian but not trying to live in obedience to God. Right? The faith that made God justify us should lead us into obedience. Right, we've got to have that thought process from one thing to another. The Son of God gave his life so that I can have a new life. I need to honor him with that life and not spend it running around every night doing things that oppose him. Right, the Son of God gave his life so that I could have this family. I want to honor him with this family. I want to establish family devotions and prayer in my house, and I want to get them to church as often as I can. The Son of God gave his life so that I could have mine. So I need to serve him with it. I need to honor him with it. I have to trust him and obey him because of my faith. And James is going to take this further by showing us the exact thought process we need to have to obey him. Right? In verses 22 and 23. A Christian's faith produces righteousness before God. Right? James says that obedience of Abraham, his works, proved his faith. His faith was completed. The true nature of his faith was revealed through his actions. Right? God sees a person's faith as true and active and real when they act on it. Right? And he says that the scripture was fulfilled. And what he's doing right now, James, is he's quoting Genesis 15:6, going back to Abraham again, where it says, Abraham believed the Lord and he counted it to him as righteousness. Okay, in Genesis 15:1-4, Abraham is crying out for a son. I need a son. You promised I'm going to make a great nation from my descendants, but I have no son. And in verse 5, the Lord took Abraham outside and said, look up into the sky and count the stars if you can. That is the number of your descendants. I think that's the moment in Abraham's life where he said, okay, I'm all in. God said he's going to do it. I believe him. This was the day that made his obedience to God in offering up Jacob possible. Okay, if there had been no Genesis 15, there would have been no Genesis 22. And this total faith in God, in faith in his protection and provision and plan, made Abraham a friend of God. That's what our scripture calls him. He was called a friend. Right? In Hebrew, that means to be made right, okay? To have a correct relationship with someone. He's talking about righteousness. Our standing before God as either sinful or not sinful. I wanted to make you aware of two different ways we can look at righteousness, and it's kind of mirror the two different ways we looked at justification. God declared our declared us justified. That's God's work. And we're talking today about living a justified life. That's our work. And in a similar way, our righteousness before God is displayed in two ways, positionally and practically. We have a positional righteousness before God where he sees us as totally righteous because we're justified, right? Christ's righteousness is imputed, right? Applied to us for all time. And that way we're positionally righteous. But what happens every single day when we wake up? Is everything that we do totally according to God's standard? No, of course not. You know, on a good day, we might get both feet on the floor, right, before we start slipping away. Our attempts at obedience to God's righteous standards, that's our practical righteousness. That's our work. That's our part. So positional righteousness, we're righteousness in God's eyes because of faith in Christ's perfect life has been applied to our record. Practical righteousness is our attempts to live that righteous life in thankful obedience for what Christ has done for us. And this is where our friend illustration comes in. Abraham was called a friend of God because he acted like a friend. He was true blue. Another great illustration by James about works through faith. You know, if there's a guy that you know and he calls you a friend, hey, friend, it's just words, isn't it? It takes more than saying you're a friend to being a friend. If he's really a friend, he's going to act in a caring, supportive, honest way towards you. He'll return your weed whacker. Right? He won't wink at your wife and he won't kick your dog. The big three, right, of friendship. James is saying here that your faith should be leading you towards doing what's right in the eyes of God. What's the right thing to do? Right? You want to obey God, so you read his word, and you say, okay, well, that's what I'm going to try and do today. But sometimes during the day, you get situations thrown upon you that you don't actually have a verse memorized for that, right? So yeah, this question should be going through your head 100 times a day. What's the right thing to do? What would God want me to do? Right, that's our practical, that's our fight for practical righteousness. You know, what's the right way to respond to hurtful comments? What's the right thing we should be watching on television? What's the right way to start my day? Getting up at the last second and get to work with 30 seconds to spare, or to get up a little bit earlier and spend time in prayer and devotion? What's right? What am I doing that shows God that I'm his friend? Could look like a lot of things, couldn't it? But you know what it's not going to look like? It's not going to look safe. And it's not supposed to. And that's our scripture's next point. A Christian's faith produces a willingness to take risks for God. You know, in verses 24 through 26, James moves his illustration of what faith should be producing from one of the most revered characters in the Old Testament to the one of the most reluctant. I mean, most of the time she's referred to in scripture has the word prostitute after her name. Talk about a legacy, right? Rahab's story is found in Joshua 2 through 6. She was a prostitute in the city of Jericho, and Jericho lay right in the way of where the Israelites were headed. So their leader, Joshua, sent two spies into the city, but they were soon discovered, and the city was ripped apart looking for these two spies. Rahab took them in, hit them on the roof, told them how the citizens of Jericho were petrified because of the power of the Israelites' God, helped the spies escape, and diverted attention to the soldiers so they could get away. She helped them escape. In return, they promised that she and her family would be spared in the upcoming battle, and they were. And there's a lot more to this story, but that would take me in a whole nother direction. So, you know, I hope we can get back to that story someday. But right now I'm going to end it right there. And, well, you can read it on your own. But this willingness of Rahab to put everything on the line was the product of a real life-saving faith. The faith that made God declare her justified in these verses. The faith that made her risk everything by living this justified life. Look at it this way. Two questions. Do God's plans always make sense? Of course not. Do God's plans ever fail? Of course not. We need to keep those two questions that we answered no to in mind when we have to decide what we're going to risk for our faith. I never read in detail up until this week, my bad, the story of Harriet Tubman. Fascinating story. I should have learned years ago. She risked everything, escaped slavery, got up north of the Mason-Dixon line and couldn't stand it. Returned 19 times to deliver 300 fellow slaves, boasting, "I never lost a passenger." Her guidance to freedom earned her the nickname Moses, and she claimed that the source of her strength and her missions came from her faith in God as deliverer and protector of the weak. "I always told God," she said, "I'm going to hold steady on you, and you're going to see me through." She risked everything, more than everything, and then went back 18 more times risking everything because she believed. That's what real saving faith does in a Christian's life. Is your life risky? It should be. You know, we live in a world that's opposed to God. The whole world we live in is opposed to what we're supposedly devoted to. There's got to be risk there. There's got to be. Will you risk relationships with your family and friends if God calls you? When the time comes, will you side with God or side with getting along, not making waves, or coexisting? You know, justified life. Walks into the principal's office and says, I'm pulling my kid out of this class until you replace it with something that doesn't totally offend our faith, and you're going to find him a new curriculum, or I'm going to go to the school board and the Christian Defense Fund. That's justified life. Justified life says, no, Mom. I know holidays are important to you and the rest of the family, but we're not skipping a Christian celebration of the resurrection of Christ to have dinner with our family. That's not what Easter is about. We can have a family dinner on Halloween. My family, anyways. Joke. Right? It's risk. The normal Christian life is a risky life. It has to be. Like Rahab's actions, these actions are not without consequences. It's not going to be smooth sailing. It's not without consequences we may have to face. That's part of the risk. Part of living a justified life, a life where all three of these principles we're talking about here today can be stitched together, right? We seek to obey God by doing what's right, no matter the cost. 1, 2, 3. All because of our faith. We seek to obey God by doing what's right, no matter the cost. Because of our faith. Obey God's word by doing what's right in his eyes and taking risks. That's really the challenge that this scripture presents us this week. If you have the life-saving, life-changing faith of the gospel of Jesus Christ, you're committed to him as your Lord and Savior, you have been justified by God. You've been declared righteous in his eyes. What effect is that having on your life in God's eyes? What should God be seeing? James is saying the effect should be living this justified life, an obedient life. I need to do what he wants. A righteous life. I need to do what's right. And a risky life. I need to do it. And we need to remember why. Because like that guy with the Rolls Royce that wouldn't roll, we need to live in amazement of what has been done for us, even though we didn't deserve it, we didn't earn it, we didn't pay for it, and we never could. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It's the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, and that we should walk in them. So as the worship team joins me up here to conclude our service, I'd just like to ask, you know, do you have saving faith? Faith that's so alive that affects your relationships with all the people around you and produces a justified life that's honoring to God. And if you don't, and you're with us here today, hang out after the service. I'm not going anywhere. We can talk about it. Maybe go grab a burger somewhere. If you're watching us on the live stream, call us up. We're here almost every single day before noon. Until noon, I should say. If you say you have faith, is it evident in your life by your obedience to God? Are you doing what he's asked you to do? Are you even listening to him so you can hear his commands? Are you in his word and obeying it? If you say you have faith, is it producing practical righteousness in your life? So much so that you can be called a friend of God. And if you say you have faith, Are you willing to risk whatever you have when God calls you? These are the products of a life-saving, life-changing faith in the life and work of Jesus Christ. A faith that's available to all people that repent and believe. Let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the words of James. Thank you for how they grip our hearts and help us to understand your plan for a Christian trying to live in faith on a planet that opposes you. Thank you for your grace and your mercy, your understanding, and your spirit that guides us. Help us to understand your will, Lord. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.